course, and I'm speaking to Callum MacDonald and Bruce Guthrie. Welcome to the programme.
Thank you, Emery.
I suppose I should be saying thank you for letting me share your dressing room, actually.
It's a
bit of a privilege.
You look better than the usual people that are in here.
So, Callum, how's it been going? I mean, the last year or so has been quite a testing time for Runrig. Do you think you've come through that all right?
Yes, I think it's been a fantastic time for us. It's been a new experience and great for us, you know, especially being as long in the tooth as we seem to be. It's like starting again, and we've all felt that, and we've all felt energised by it, and just really enjoyed it, which is, you know, the end of the day, it's what you want out of this business.
Yeah.
And we've loved it, loved every minute of it, and, you know, we'll continue in that vein.
And the fans seem to be quite happy with all the changes?
Oh, yes, some of them, of course. You always get your grousers, but the vast majority are with us, are on board. And the good thing is we've picked up a new audience now, mm-hmm. which is exciting as well.
Now, the band, I think the first gig was in 1973, something like that.
Well, if you can remember that far back, then I'll
wasn't there,
I believe
I'll
you. Yes, it was.
So it must be amazing just thinking about them, all the gigs that you've been through and the time that you've all been together.
It's quite frightening, really, yes. But when you go back to 73, it was a very different kettle of fish altogether. It was a very different band. It's just that the name has survived since then. And maybe that's a good thing, because you can see it, you know, going through all the different changes musically and personnel-wise. And
do you think there are certain points that mark these changes that's happened to the band?
Oh, loads of milestones along the way, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Come on, elaborate.
How many would you like?
Well,
the present band probably started in about 86, and the most significant time was around about the early 90s, when the band was probably at its peak in terms of popular appeal, if you like. But we've had fans from the very start that have stayed with us, very, very loyal. And
so why do you think that 86 was such a big turning point? Did your sound change quite a lot in that time?
The sound was just constantly evolving through the years, and the Cutter and the Clan album was the one that broke through for us.
Mm-hmm.
It just caught the imagination. And the type of venues we were doing then, we were playing a lot of student venues, and there's a kind of groundswell of support as these things happen, you know. Mm-hmm. Just a lot of it is being fortunate as well. You're there at that particular time. And also, I suppose, the whole social aspect of it, the political aspect. A lot of people, you know, the kind of pro-devolution, the road leading up to devolution. A lot of people got in the bandwagon then and maybe saw Runrig as a kind of some kind of soundtrack for their feelings and how to express them.
That's quite difficult, maybe, to live up to people's expectations.
Well, you don't. I mean, you just live up to your own.
And you're managing to do that?
No, but you try.
Okay, well, we'll speak to Bruce in just a minute, but we're going to hear Bruce Guthrie, and the album is Of Your Son, and this is Hobo Train.
On a hobo train.
see me on a highway, you might hear me in a song. You might touch me with an act of faith, but you'll not hold me very long.
Celtic Connections here on Radio Scotland, and I'm speaking to Callum MacDonald and Bruce Guthrow from Runrig, and you just heard Bruce there with Hobo Train from his very successful album of your son. Now, you haven't had much time to do your own stuff in the last wee while, Bruce. Has that been quite hard for you?
It's actually, it's a pretty decent balance. I'm over here probably 4 to 5 months of the year, so that leaves me the rest of the time over in North America. So I've been actually busy recently with making a new record, so It's a good balance. It's never boring. Always switching, always turning pages.
Good. Always a good thing. Mm. So how did you actually get involved with Runrig? I mean, how did it first come to their attention?
Well, they were apparently looking for a lead singer for approximately a year, if I'm not mistaken. And Marlene's son, Gordy, was over driving a team of Huskies in northern Canada and happened to hear me sing. I had written a song for Natalie McMaster and that he had heard, and I did a duet with one of the Rankin family girls. And he heard that as well, so we brought it back over, and I guess Marlene and the lads heard the voice and thought it was worth a shot. So next thing you know, my manager got a call, and I was on my way to Scotland for what they call an audition, and I call a begging session.
We didn't know what he looked like at that point, of course. When we saw him, we really wondered, you know.
What did you wonder when you saw him?
We can't have this guy, can we?
He's far too young looking for the band. That was the thought at the time.
But Callum, what was it about Bruce's voice that you thought was just so different from all the other people you'd been auditioning? Because, you know, it was a long time that you were looking for someone.
Yeah, it's people ask, you know, what is it you're looking for? And you can never really explain what you're looking for. And it's not that it's different, it was just right. Mm-hmm. And you can't really explain it because we'd been through so many auditions. And the curious thing is there was a lot of Scottish singers, well, most of them were Scottish, and very, very good singers, you know, as we came to the final end of the audition. But I think in Bruce we detected something. I know for me I detected something Hebridean. You know, he just lives in an island the same as me, and it's just on the other side of the Atlantic. But you know, if you strip away the kind of the cultural things, the stereotypes, you know, at the heart of Cape Breton and the heart of North Uist or Skye or one of these places, you find the same people, you find the same music. And I certainly, and a lot of us, detected that in Bruce's voice.
So what about your, is there a lot of Scottish ancestry in your family?
There is on my dad's side. My great-grandmother spoke more Gaelic than she did English. Mm-hmm. But there's a lot of French in there as well. I've never really traced my roots all the way back over to here, but the island itself is just filled with Celtic influences and culture, and a lot of it comes from actually the Highlands. That's where everybody landed when they came to North America. There was a great landing in Cape Breton.
So he came over to Scotland and took Donny Monroe's place. Now that must have that must have been a bit scary, wasn't it?
You know, it wasn't so bad because I had not heard of the band. The band had been to Canada, but never to the north, never to Atlantic Canada. Mm-hmm. So I didn't really know what I was stepping into until I got here. And when we did the first gig, I believe it was a tuna festival in Denmark, I finally got a taste of this core fan base, and it really took me back. It really did. After the first show, then I started to get a little bit more nervous. But for the most case, starting off, I'm just trying to remember words and melody, and I'm not worried about the pressures of following anyone's footsteps. And it's like Calum said before, you just try and live up to your own expectations and don't worry about what anybody else thinks. And if you can do that, you'll do okay.
The drag for Bruce is, and for us too, is you keep getting asked, you know, so what about the new guy? And it's 3 years now, you know, so.
But you're always going to be the new guy, aren't you?
So if I was a thorn in your arse for 3 years, would I still be the new? Would I still be called new?
All right. Well, on that thorny note, I think we should maybe go and hear some more music. This is The Message from Runrig's album In Search of Angels.
To the water, and you watch the rain.
wasted all our young years. Who's to say we never tried to live fast and honor our pledges? Here we vowed to stay young till we die. We drank the life from the last of the bottle. We wrote our message out like a prayer. Then we threw away the message with all our hearts. And we watched our lives disappear.
Message from the album In Search of Angels. Calum, how difficult was it to record that album? Because that was the first one with Bruce.
It was half with Bruce. That was the real difficulty, because we had come to the conclusion that whatever else we did, we would record an album, whether we got a singer or not, because at this point we hadn't heard of Bruce, and we were at the point of tearing our hair out and not getting anywhere as far as the lead singer is concerned. And we wouldn't have gone ahead to play live or taking the band to another stage if we hadn't found the right person. We wouldn't just have got somebody that would do. It had to be right, or, you know, creatively you had to feel positive about it. So we decided that whatever else we were going to do, we were going to record. So we went into the studio and started recording with Rory doing the vocals. Mm-hmm. And it was halfway through that process. The songs had been written. And it was halfway through the process when Bruce came on board. So there was immediately a difficulty there, because the keys were all set and some of them worked and some of them had to be changed. So that whole process was long and drawn out and complicated. Yeah, it had its pressures, but we're very happy with the result.
And what about in Cape Breton, Bruce? What do they think of the album there?
They love it, yeah. It's right now, you can't get it in Canada unless you want to order it through email or get it across. But I take my own little cases home every time I go, and everybody wants one. They're very curious. We're looking forward. Eventually, the band will definitely go over and play the East Coast, and everyone's looking forward to it. And
you find Bruce every Sunday he's down in Halifax in a street corner with his case. He's sold a few
singing
now.
Runrig songs. Yeah.
As long as he's making money, that's all right, and gives it back to you. You've played all over the world, but it has to be said that Germany has really got a very special place for you in their hearts. Why do you think that is? Why are you such a big hit in Germany?
Again, a lot of it's just good fortune in many ways. We had a couple of big radio hits there in a certain part of Germany. One of the major radio stations, equivalent of maybe Radio 1 in Britain, came on board, and a guy really liked us and played us to death over a period mm-hmm. in the late 80s. And it just built from there, and it's that step you need. And the German people, they took to us, the audience took to us and built from there.
And the Danes have taken to you as well. I just find it amazing that Carlsberg chose you to do their adverts. You know what the Danes are like? Quite proud of their own music and their own culture.
It was even more bizarre, the piece of music they chose. We couldn't believe it when we heard. And initially, I know Rory and I were very much against the idea of using that particular song, because we just didn't think it fitted at all, apart from, you know, wanting to, or the feeling of prostituting yourself in that way. But I have to say, I'm glad we did it. I think a lot of good's come out of it for us.
Okay, and that song went into the charts, didn't it?
Yes, it did. Yeah, it was number 18 in the charts, I think. And that was a real thrill, because it was the first Gaelic song in the top 20, you know, so that was It's just one of these, it doesn't really mean much in one sense, but it does in another.
Oh, yeah, certainly is. Yeah. Big achievement. So, coming back to Cape Breton, what about all your friends in Cape Breton? What do they think of all this Runrig thing? Do they think that you did the right thing by joining the band?
Oh, I believe so. It was nice to have Celtic connections over here. It was nice to have a bunch of them over. We have Celtic colors in Cape Breton. And so when they all come over, finally, good percentage of them had a chance to see me perform with the band, so it took some of the mystery away, and I got a chance to actually see some people from home and say, mm-hmm. So what do you think, you know, and to get some responses, and it's all been positive. They love it, and they can't wait to get us over there. So
yeah, your friends from home are usually the sternest critics as well, aren't they?
Most truthful, that's for sure. Yeah, the ones you know the longest are more apt to give you a true response.
Okay, well, some more music now. We're going to hear another track from the album In Search of Angels. This is Runrig, and this is not a love song.
Morning comes. Oh, no. not a love song. This is no easy tune. Words are few, but the heart is true. It all keeps coming round for me and you. This is not a love song.
Speaking to Calum and Bruce from the band. So Calum, what are your plans? What's happening at the moment?
Well, at the moment we're just coming to the end of our next album, which is due out in the spring. It's virtually completed and we're very excited about it.
Will that be quite different from the album we just heard there, In Search of Angels?
Yes, yeah, I think there's a very strong departure. It carries elements of maybe going back to maybe some of the listeners remember the Recovery album, but it touches on a raw part of Gaelic tradition or the folk tradition that we touched on in those days. So there'll be elements of that, strong elements of that, and also other elements stirring into areas we haven't gone into before as well. So, and also with Bruce on board, there's a couple of songs featuring Bruce, or written by Bruce. There's one he's written with Malcolm, a lovely ballad. So there's that is different as well.
Is that quite hard for you to maybe give up a bit of that, well, not give it up, but to welcome someone else on board writing songs? Because it has really been you and Rory.
No, we arm wrestle about it. We get around a table and you know, wrestle out. So Bruce won that slot, you know.
The whole album, if that was the case.
Moving
you know
swiftly
the life
on.
We're bragging, these Canadians. Yeah.
These guys, I think they're completely welcome to me doing some writing and stuff. The big thing, as far as I'm concerned, is that Calum and Rory have written songs for Runrig for 25 years or 30 or however long it's been. Easy, steady.
Not quite 30.
So it's no secret that I write my own songs and I'm a writer and I'm in no hurry. I can use my solo career as an outlet for that. Mm-hmm. If songs fit the records and they manage to make it on a record, it'll be for good reason. It'll have to be right. And this one in particular, one that I co-wrote with Malcolm, it just seemed to really call for this album. So,
yeah. It's great for us. I mean, it's just stimulating to get somebody else that writes. It's good to have Bruce in the band where Rory and I can talk about songwriting now. You know, and a language that just songwriters know. It's a strange kind of territory that musicians don't know anything about. Am I right?
Like drummers and people like that.
Are they musicians?
Oh, it's open to debate, isn't it? All right, but you've got a new album coming out and also a songbook. That's very exciting.
Yes, that's been a huge project that Rory and I have been busy at for about a year and a half solid. It's been a massive task and it's now finished. The book is now arrived. It's in a ship on its way to Scotland at the moment. Mm-hmm. And we're very excited about it. When we started off doing it was just going to be a book with a standard songbook with lyrics and manuscript. But it just grew from there. We wrote a lot about the songs and the inspiration or anecdotes concerning each song. And there's 115 songs in total.
And
pictures, loads of photos. And we just tried to create something different. It just grew and grew and grew, and it's a huge, big, thick thing now, and it's out. But we're very excited about it.
Where can people get hold of that, then?
Well, at the moment, we're just selling it through the Runrig merchandising, through the fan club. So if there's anyone that's interested in getting it, maybe they could write in or phone in, and, mm-hmm. and I'm sure you'll be able to supply the details.
Yeah, well, you know the email address here, celtic.connections@bbc.co.uk, or of course you can write, that's Celtic Connections, BBC Scotland, Queen Margaret Drive, Glasgow, G12 8DG. Well, another couple of very important dates before we say goodbye to Calum and Bruce. You're touring at the moment, Glasgow just now. Where are you headed to next?
Well, we're down to England. We're going to Sheffield tomorrow night. Then I'll probably get this order wrong. London. And then back up to Scotland for two shows, Friday in Alloa and Saturday finishing off in Hawick.
Well, thanks very much indeed. And we wish you all the best. I'm sure it'll be a great tour.
Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Oh,